You alone are faithful. You alone are faithful, yeah. Messiah, you will not be changed. Oh, 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 yeah. Though the world moves like men, you alone are faithful. You alone are faithful. Yes, you are Messiah. You will not be changed.
Hallelujah. Amen. 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 Amen.
Who is like him? The Lion and the Lamb, seated on the throne. Mountains bow down, every ocean roars to the Lord of hosts.
Oh, you sound good. Sing that again.
Who is like him? The Lion and the Lamb, seated on the throne.
Hallelujah.
Mountains bow down, every ocean roars to the Lord of hosts. Days are your night, from the rising of the sun till the end of every day. Days are your night, for the nations of the earth, for the angels. Sing praise Adonai, from the rising of the sun to the end of every day. Praise Adonai, for the nations of the earth, for the angels and the saints. Sing praise. Ooh, oh.
Sing that again. Who's like
who is like him? The Lion and the Lamb, seated on the throne. Mountains bow down, every ocean roars the Lord of all.
Oh, you sound great. Sing it again. Come on.
Who is like him? The Lion and the Lamb, seated on the throne. Mountains bow down, every ocean roars to the Lord of all. Praise that all night. Praise God all night. From the rising of the sun till the end of every day. Praise Adonai, for the nations of the earth, for the angels to sing. Sing praise Adonai, from the rising of the sun till the end of every day. Praise Adonai,
love him? Has he been good to you? I don't hear anybody. Has he been good to you? Oh, didn't he get you here safe tonight? Huh? Hallelujah. Praise him. Come on.
Praise Adonai, from the rising of the sun till the end of every day. Praise Adonai,
all the nations of the earth, all the angels and the saints, they will raise Adonai. From the rising of the sun to the end of every day, oh, and raise Adonai. All the nations of the earth, all the angels and the saints, somebody give him praise, give him praise, give him praise. I love you, Lord, I love you, Lord, I love you, Lord. Woo! Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. It's good to be here tonight. You're welcome. How's your mom doing? God is so good. Well, I had to come into town this week for one of those trips when your kids need you. I mean, you know what I'm talking about. So I really enjoyed driving 2 days to get here, but God is good. They're doing good. They just need a little help from their dad and, amen. Pastor Hector asked me to come down and do a few songs. I said, yeah, man, absolutely, Pastor Hector. God's so good. You know what I love about when you study his word, you study the Torah portion. Each week there's a life experience that's happening within the scriptures that really... It's almost like you feel like you're going through the same thing that week. You know what I mean? Like, what? I don't think it's a coincidence. Amen. Hallelujah, hallelujah. My God is awesome. He can move mountains. Guides me through the valley. Leads me to the rain. My God is all. Heals me when I'm broke. Gives strength where I've been weakened. Ever he will reign. My God is all. Help me say, hallelujah. Awesome, awesome, yes he is awesome, come on, my God, he is awesome, yes he is awesome. Savior, Savior of the world, giver of salvation, by his stripes I'm healed. My God is awesome. Come on, today I am forgiven. His grace is why I'm living. Sing that one again. My God is awesome. Savior, Savior. By his stripes, by his stripes, I'm healed. My God is awesome. Today I am forgiven. Yes, I am. Praise his holy name. I got a divine song. That's right. Awesome. Woo. Awesome. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Oh. Yes, he is. Oh, yeah. Yes, he is. Oh, yes, he is. Awesome. My God is all. I love you, Lord. Yeah. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. You've been so good to me, Adonai. Even when I fail you so many times, such mercy, Lord God. When I've had negative thoughts, wicked thoughts, you or your mercy and your grace comes to my rescue in a blink, and I embrace your righteousness and your holiness. I love you, Lord. I give myself away. Yes, I do, Lord. I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. Oh, yes, I do. Yes, I do.
Sing it again.
I give myself away so you can use me.
Here I am.
Here I am. Here I stand. Lord, my life is in your hand. Lord, I belong. Need to see.
Yes, I am.
Your desires revealed in me. I give myself away. Yes, I do, Lord. Oh, yeah. I give myself away so you can use me. Give myself away. Myself away so you can use me. Take my heart.
That's what he wants.
Take my life as a living sacrifice. Oh, my dream. My plans, Lord, I place them in your hand.
Come on, help me say it.
I give myself away. Yes, I do, Lord, yes. I give myself away. Now you can you. Every word spoken, Lord, take it, Lord. please you. Allow me, Lord, to please you. Allow me, Lord, to please you all. Take my heart, Lord. Take my heart, Lord, Lord. I just want to please you, Lord. I just want to please you, Lord. I just want to please you, Lord. I give myself away. Favor. How many want his shadow to lead you in everything he does? When you turn left, you turn right. Hallelujah. Lord, grant us your favor. Grant us your favor. Like Ephraim and Manasseh, Lord. Your people would be blessed. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. I can go all night, Pastor, so you better just. Here we go. How many, you know, in light of what's going on in this dark, in light of what's going on in this dark and lost world, I don't even want, it's, you know, as much as I love to be informed, I don't even want to hear the news anymore. How many cannot wait for a righteous government? How many can't wait for a righteous government? Justice and honor. A righteous government to rule the land. I don't know about you, but I can't wait for my Messiah, my King, to rule over this place. Amen. I'm waiting here for you with my hand. And it's you we adore, singing hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I'm waiting here for you. High, high,
singing hallelujah. Your name is like honey on my lips. Your spirit like water to my soul. Your word is a lamp to my feet. Yeshua, I love you. I love you. Your name is like honey.
Listen, if it wasn't for him, I would have died in the Bronx a long time ago. Yeshua, I love you. Yes, I love you. Yeshua, I love you. Oh, yeah, I love you. Yeshua.
Get our pulpit up here. Come on, let's give God praise one more time. And Pastor Bobby Roman, hallelujah. Don't take that too far, because we may close with a song and maybe a Aaronic prayer, if you don't mind doing that for us. I know he did a beautiful Aaronic prayer the last time. Amen. He did a beautiful job. Well, let's do the Shema. Because God is on the throne, and he's awesome. I will worship all night long. I tell you what, I wouldn't mind doing that, but people are trying to get on the streaming already, so we got to keep on schedule for that. But again, let's do the Shema, and let's worship our God. Let's do it together. One, two, three. Shema Israel. Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad, Baruch Shekvo, Malkuto, Leolam Vayed. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. Blessed is the name and glorious kingdom forever and ever. Adonai, Adonai, Yeshua HaMashiach, Adonai. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu, Yeshua HaMashiach, Adonai. Lord, Lord, Yeshua the Messiah, he is Lord. Blessed are you, Lord God, Yeshua the Messiah, for he is Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. You may be seated in the house of the Lord. God bless you, all of you who are here today. Pastor Bobby Roman, we thank you for being here. Amen. He told me he was going to be in town. I said, come on, man, you got to come in on Thursday. I know that we have Torah study. And I said, I'm going to announce it. And thank God we have, pretty decent crowd tonight. Thursday, I know it's hard for some people. I was explaining to him that we have a lot of people from our congregation live kind of far. You know, not everybody lives in the Tampa Bay area. We have people from Brandon, Spring Hill, Ocala, from Orlando. We have people from Orlando to come every weekend. And so it's a long trip. So, you know, but the people that are here are here. You were blessed tonight more than the others. Amen. How many of you were blessed tonight? Amen. Praise the Lord. Come on. Give God praise again. Also, I just want to say, because we're believing. We're talking. We've been mitrashing. And the last time he was here, I kind of put a seed in him. I said, look, you know what? I'm believing for a praise and worship leader for our congregation. And I said, you're from the Bronx, I'm from Brooklyn, man. Come on. I mean, we're brothers, and then we're Puerto Ricans too. So, and then we're Sephardic Jews on top of that. And he believes in the Hebrew roots, you know. So, and you know, I met him at a Messianic conference. So, I don't know how many years ago, but we hit it off right away. And his wife and my wife and everybody else, we just feel akin to spirit. But I'm believing that God's going to bring the finances since I could afford them. Because, you know, I mean, look, how many, a man is worthy of his hire. And, you know, this is his living. This is his living. This is how he makes, you know, of course, a ministry. I mean, when you're called by God, God will supply. You know, God will supply the finances. So I'm believing. And you know, we talked about it. I said, look, I know when that offer comes in, it's going to be the right one. And then he's going to, because he wants to move back. He lives in Texas. He wants to move back to Florida because he has family in Florida. He has roots here. Amen. So we believe him. We're going to somehow bring him back. And then he's going to be part of our congregation. Amen. And we have a praise and worship leader. And from there, you never know. We have a band. We'll have a band. God knows. Come on. I'm believing this is the year of Shemitah. The Shemitah year is a year of release, a year of increase, a year of shaking. It means shaking. And the Shemitah is very profound between now and 2015, between now and September for the Feast of Tabernacles that is coming up. Don't forget, the blood moons are coming out again, doing Passover this year and for the Feast of Tabernacles, which is back-to-back from last year, which it hasn't happened in a long, long time. And when that happens, God is saying something. God is moving. God is starting to do something. And if you see the world, how many of you know that? How many of you believe we're in the end of days? We're in the end. This is the end. We're in the end of days. And remember, we taught on the end times. And the end time is just not about the world coming to an end. The end time is about, if you look at the end times prophecies of the Bible, it's about worldly kingdoms going out and godly kingdom coming in. Because God is going to take this kingdom of this world and say, whoop, out. And the kingdom of the world is out and the kingdom of God is in. Because again, how many of you know his kingdom is going to rule and reign for eternity? So it's just, all of this is just, again, a setup. You know, it's being set up, and the enemy knows it. And the enemy, again, all these murders, all these killings, all of this, believe me, these are sacrifices from the devil. And again, that's what's happening. So, are you ready for the Torah study tonight? All right, we're in the book of Exodus. Let's turn to Exodus chapter 6, and we're if I could get my water here, good. If I could get everybody just to turn to chapter 6, and let's pass the Roman a bottle, and we are in the Torah portion of Vayera. And I didn't say Viagra, I said Viara. All right? Even though some of us need some spiritual Viagra, amen, praise the Lord. How many of you know that? Come on, you gotta lighten up. And it means that he appeared. And those who are watching, is V-A apostrophe E-R-A, all right? the era. And let's start with Exodus chapter 6. But before we read the scripture, let me set it up. I want everybody to say, I didn't see it coming. Sometimes we don't see things coming. And Moses, let's look at Moshe. We call him Moshe in Hebrew. Moshe is traveling back to Egypt. Was not just a trip to, how many of you know the corner 7-Eleven? It was quite a journey, first of all. And during this time, the word spoken to him at the burning bush and his conversation with Yahweh was probably played over and over again in his mind. He probably came up with it with 100 ways that this could go. He said, wait a minute, a bush is talking to me? As the imagination became reality, at some point he probably thought to himself, I didn't see that coming. Because all of a sudden, this bush started talking to him. And it was God. With every plague, watch this now. With every plague that the Pharaoh is becoming a more, how many of you know that there were so many of them, 10 actually, but how many of you know that Pharaoh was probably ticked off? He was getting really angry. And to make matters worse, Moshe again is living with the fact that his own family, the Hebrews, are not too happy with him either. How many of you know that? The difference between his current situation and the one 40 years earlier is that he's able to see the hand of Elohim working in his midst. This is what gives him strength. Now, to fully understand this, let's look at where Moshe is at. We must take a look at the word I use. I want you to write the word see, not, what did I do with that? Did I put it there? I just had it in my hand, didn't I? The marker. I just had a marker. Oh, there it is. I put it down here. I hit it. I don't know why I did that. Write the word see. All right? I say I didn't see it coming, right? Now, the word see in Hebrew is the word ra. Okay? Is the word ra. Now, in the English word see, it basically is to look upon something with what? With our eyes. But this limits us to what is called a natural vision. And we have to be careful not to see, not to always look at things in the natural vision. We have to start looking at things in the spiritual vision. So that's why I wanted you to write this word down, because if you look at it in the Hebrew word for see is ra, which means it's not only seeing with our eyes, but to perceive, to consider. With our spirit. So as to, again, perceive with our spirit, consider what God is showing us with our spirit. Now, let's look at it this way. When a situation arises in life, whether good or bad, from our perspective, we have a choice. Everybody say we have a choice. Now, we can either see it through our eyes. And right now, we're looking at things with our eyes, and we're saying, this is horrible, what's going on in the world today. Babies being thrown off a bridge alive. A little beautiful girl. What possesses a man, a father, to do that? I mean, think about that. You got to be possessed by the devil. I mean, it's got to be devil. The devil is using this person. For what reason? What was the reason? Because, you know, basically, well, I'm pretty sure he was nuts, but, you know, the reason was, if I can't have her, you can't have her. Even though that beautiful little girl's in heaven, amen, with the Lord, and this is to me, I've heard, oh, she's an angel now, this is to me, children, when you die, if you're a child, you do not become an angel. Because angels have already been created. All right, she is a child in heaven. She is a child in heaven, and she's walking with Yeshua. The angels have already been created. We don't die to become angels. Angels have already been created. You find that in Job 38. So a child does not become an angel. They become, again, they become a child of God in the presence of God, in the kingdom of God. And that child automatically is with the kingdom. The Bible says that when a child dies, automatically, they don't have to go to the salvation process because the closest thing to God is children. Right? Okay. So, but when a situation arises in life, whether good or bad, from our perspective, we have a choice. We can either see it through our eyes or we can see it through whose eyes? His eyes. So we have to start looking. This Torah portion is about, again, looking at things through God's eyes. Everybody say amen. For Moshe and the Hebrews, a greater work had to be done simply leaving Egypt. It's just not about leaving Egypt. Egypt was going to have to leave them. Come on. And to many of us, in our perspective, we have left Egypt, but Egypt has not left us. If you look at the church in general today, come on, we can't tell the difference between the church and the world. We really can't. So if we are supposed to leave Egypt behind, you know, where are we? Everybody say amen. Amen. So God is doing what he's allowing to happen now, because again, he's coming back soon. And again, he has to shake what has to be shaken. He has to. Because again, he has to test his creation to the point where he's going to have to divide who's with him and who's not. And that's what it's all about. Everybody say amen. Because God says he's going to come, but unfortunately, it's going to be only a remnant at the end. It's not going to be everybody. We would love it to be everybody. God wants it to be everybody. He died for everyone. But not everyone is going to accept him. Not everyone is going to accept him. Even in the body of Christ, we still have people, you know, how can I say, having two different opinions, wavering between two opinions. Many years have passed. Let's go back. Now, many years have passed since Yaakov, of course, Jacob, and his family has entered Egypt. When they arrived, the Hebrews were, again, basically, adoring to the Egyptians. And the Egyptians were adoring to the Hebrews. At time had passed, the Hebrews had settled into what is called the life of Egypt. And sometimes we settle into a life that is not godly. Too many of them, the land and the ways of Egypt have become who they were. It became them. That's my identity. It was home to them. The act of delivering the Hebrews from Egypt meant Egypt had to once again become adorned to them. The purpose of the plagues was not only to judge the pride and arrogance of Egypt, but to destroy Egypt in the heart of the Hebrews. Because the Hebrews have to die. And how many of you know, when you read the scriptures, they were complaining. You brought us here, Moses. I should have stayed where I was. And come on now, listen to me. How many of you, when you got saved, you said, man, wait a minute. I should have stayed where I was. I was there. When I got saved, all hell broke loose. I had it pretty good without God. I had everything I needed, what I thought and what I saw was good. But in the spirit realm, I was losing. I was losing big time. But how many of you know that sometimes we see things in that manner? So the act of delivering, again, the Egyptians were against about pride and all the things that they had to overcome. We see in later readings of the book of Exodus that they will be more difficult than even Moses could even have thought. Because how many of you know the 40 years, that was an 11-day trip, you know that. It was not a long trip. that God had to keep him in the wilderness because 40 years, and 40 is a representation of generation. You might want to write that down to know 40 is the number of generation. And God had to keep a generation in the wilderness. Why? Because God was not pleased, because even though he took them out of Egypt, Egypt was still embedded in them, rooted in their heart, heartened in their heart to the things of God. With all this said, let's bring it to our day today. It appears the whole world has entered, let's write this down if you can, the whole world has entered into a time of plagues. In other words, what plagues us right now? From Ebola in Africa to the killings in Paris to the killings in New York. And we were in New York when that police officer funeral was going on. And he went to a church in Queens. He was an usher. He was a counselor. He was a man of God. You know, a death that was, you know, then the other his partner, both, wasted life. For why? For what reason? But just to kill them? A sacrifice of the enemy. So the world is being set on fire, isn't it? Right? Now, I, for one, believe it's just the beginning. It's the beginning of the birth pain. And I was telling Evelyn, when you see this stuff going on in Paris, I believe, again, because it's going to happen more often. A week later, now Belgium today. Another. But still, and then they're not going to get ISIS. Listen to me. ISIS is basically led by Islamic extremists that they see things with their eyes, and their eyes is death. They glorify death, and their goal is to change the world to Islam. Either you going to conform to their way or you die. That's the way it is. And they're taking over. I mean, in Europe, they're taking over Europe. I mean, they have places in Europe that in Paris, that they have settlements there that even the French police government and the government cannot even go in there. Wait a minute. All right, so let me go to Iraq or to Iran or to Saudi Arabia or to Yemen. Let me go to those countries and say, okay, I'm going to establish my Messianic congregation, and you're not allowed to come in. What do you think will happen? We will get our heads chopped off. But they could do it in this country, or they could do it in that country. Wait a minute. So what is happening? Sharia law is about their government. They're waiting for the Mahdi to come, which is the 12th Imam, which is again the caliphate. Caliphate is another word for government of Islam. So they're trying to establish their government. And let me tell you something. The average ISIS, especially places like in Africa, those guys that are fighting in Africa, the average fighter in those countries are getting paid $20,000 a year. It may not be a lot to you, but to them, these guys don't even make $500 a year. So $20,000 a year for them is a lot of money. So they're paying these guys, come on, like mercenaries. And they're basically joining up all day long by thousands and thousands of them, because again, their own government wasn't paying them what they needed to live. Now ISIS is coming in and said, look, we'll pay you to fight with us. Some of them 20,000, and it all depends on what country, and because they look at the average yearly wage and they quadruple it 100 times over. And of course, if you're starving to death and you can't feed your children, trust me, you're going to become an ISIS fighter. So again, this is rooted all in the devil. There are going to be events, let me say this, in the near future, which will make us stand with Moshe and say, I didn't see it coming. I don't think we saw, in 2011, 9/11, we didn't see that coming. We didn't see the Boston Marathon bombing. We didn't see the Paris. We didn't see that kosher supermarket. And look what they attack a kosher market against the Jews, a lot of Jews in Paris. The choice each of us has to face is the decision to not see these events with our eyes, but to pray for the sermon to Ra. Everybody say Ra. To Ra. In other words, to see through God's eyes. For there is a greater purpose going on in our midst than just those lousy old politicians being judged for the way they are treating us. The plagues in Egypt were not only to take the Hebrews out of Egypt, but to take the Egypt out of the Hebrews. So with each plague, Egypt was being chipped, come on, from their hearts, and a greater work was being done. In the end, many will not let Egypt go. I'm telling you right now, the Bible says it. There will be people that will shake their fists at God and not conform. There's people today, when you try to even bring the Hebrew roots of their faith and try to explain to them the Hebrew roots, they will look at you like you're some kind of nut. I had a comment. I just had one of my brothers today. I walked into the church and said, man, I was talking to a family about the Hebrew roots or what I was learning, and they got mad at me because I was telling them. Well, people are going to get mad at the truth anyway because they don't want to hear it. Nobody wants to hear that what they're doing and what they've been doing, what their grandmother did, it was wrong. but again, are we seeing it with our eyes or are we seeing it with God's eyes? God established the Sabbath, not man. God established everything when it comes to the Hebrew roots. I have another woman that I'm dealing with right now. She says, pray for me because I'm back. I kind of planted a seed in her about the Hebrew roots. And she's a real faithful believer. And she says, I'm being tormented. Because what you told me, I looked it up and it is real. And when I'm going to church and I'm not being taught what you're saying. I'm not learning this. So I said, well, I said, I'm glad you're going through that turmoil because they've seen things with their eyes. Amen? Now, when we see things coming and they are not the way we expected, remember, let us pray and say, may Ra, may I see the greater work which you are doing. And again, not only in the world, but what you're doing within me. Because God is working in us. Everybody say amen. Amen. All right. Let's get into this Torah portion. Let's read from Exodus chapter 6. And let's try to see if we could make sense of this. That was my introduction, okay? All right. Exodus chapter 6, verse 2. Then we're going to go to the Haftorah in Ezekiel 28. And then the Brit Hadashah, or the New Testament, in Acts chapter 10. Exodus chapter 6, verse 2. And God said to Moses, I am who? It says, I am Yahweh. Does your Bible say Yahweh? That's his name. Not just God. Remember, God is a generic name. Krishna's a God. Even the devil wants to be his own God. Pharaoh was a God. Confucius was a God. They're still confused. Right? But he says, God said, I am Yahweh. I got to stop here and say something. Yesterday I was listening to a radio program. And this guy has a PhD in theology. He's written books. I'm not going to mention his name because everybody probably, I think most of you have heard of him. But somebody called him in and said about, you know, and called in and mentioned to him about how the Bible was written in Hebrew. And he said, yes, you know, it was, but, you know, again, then it was written in Greek. And so basically he was trying to say we follow the Greek way more than the Hebrew. So the question was asked, is even when he makes this comment, I go, wait, this guy's supposed to be a doctor of theology. And he said, when the angel came to Mary, first of all, her name wasn't even Mary. Her name was Miriam in Hebrew. Okay? How many of you know Mary's an Italian name? No, I'm kidding. Spanish, Italian. But her name was Miriam. That she, he even said, and the angel said, he says, I'm going to prove it to you, I'm going to read it. And the angel said, because there was, he said, wait a minute. Because the caller was saying, but if God is Hebrew, why do we call him Jesus? Isn't his name Yeshua? And he was saying, oh, you can call him whatever you want. It all depends. If you're a Messianic, or if you're a Messianic, most Messianics call him Yeshua. But most people in the body of Christ call him Jesus. So it's either way, it'd be okay. I'm not saying, look, it's okay. I'm saying that if you call him Jesus, I would say that in the name of Jesus. And God understands that if I don't know any better and I call him Jesus, and I say, Jesus, my Lord, coming into my life, how many of you know he's going to come into my life? Because he did. But once you know his real name, how many of you know it's respect and honoring to call him by his real name? Okay? All right? It's just like a person who was born in South America. His name is George. You don't call him George. His name is Jorge. Right? Because if you call him George in South America, he'll never turn around and look at you. Right? And if you call Yeshua Jesus in Israel, trust me, he would not turn around. Because everybody spoke Hebrew. And that was his name. But then he was saying that the angel came. He says, I can prove it to you, because he wants to see how smart he is, because he has a PhD in theology. He wants to show that in the New Testament that the angel came to Mary and told Mary, call him Jesus. So Jesus is his real name. I go, you mean to tell me that this angel who speaks Hebrew in the first place is speaking to a Hebrew woman, a Jew, and he's going to say, name him Jesus? I don't think so. He says he's going to speak to her in her language, and he's going to say, Miriam, you're going to be with child, and his name is Yeshua. Because the word Yeshua means salvation and deliverer. And that's who he is. The name Jesus doesn't mean that. If you look it up, it doesn't mean that. Everybody say amen. So in other words, are we going to see things with our eyes or a Greek eye, or are we going to see it with the Hebrew? Everybody say the Hebrew. All right, let's read on. He says, I am Yahweh, the Lord. Verse 3, I appeared to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob as who? El Shaddai, which means what? God Almighty. It's not El Cheapo. Is El Shaddai, amen? But I did not reveal my name, Yahweh, to them, and I reaffirmed my covenant with them under its terms. I promised to give them the land of Canaan, where they were living as foreigners. You could be sure that I have heard the groans of the people of Israel, who are now slaves to the Egyptians, and I am well aware of the covenant with them. Therefore, say to the people of Israel, I am the Lord. I will free you from your oppression and will rescue you from your slavery in Egypt. I will redeem you with a powerful arm and great acts of judgment. I will claim you as my own people, and I will be your God. Then you will know that I am the Lord your God, who has freed you from the oppression in Egypt. Everybody say amen. Okay? Now, let's go to Ezekiel 28 to cross-reference this real quick. Ezekiel 28, because that's the half-Torah in Ezekiel. And chapter 28, he's going to just kind of cross-reference this. How many of you know when you read the Torah, the Torah is not only the first five books, but it's the whole Bible. So everything cross-references, and Scripture confirms Scripture. That's how you learn the Bible. Exodus chapter 28. I mean, Ezekiel 28, verse 25.
Again, confirmation of what we just read. This is what the sovereign Lord says. The people of Israel will again live in their own land, the land that I gave my servant Jacob, for I will gather them from the distant lands where I have scattered them. How many of you know this is a prophecy for us too? I will reveal to the nations of the distant lands where I have scattered them. I will reveal to the nations of the world my holiness among my people. They will live safely in Israel, build homes and plant vineyards. How many of you know that's happening? In Israel right now, that dry land that, remember, before Israel got there in 1948, Israel was dry as a desert. And now it's prosperous. They're selling and exporting more fruits and vegetables than any other country. Because why? God's hand is on it. God's hand is on Israel. Everybody say amen. Which means God's hand is on us. They will live safely in Israel and build homes and plant vineyards. And when I punish the neighboring nations, how many of you know he's going to punish the neighboring nations that treated them with contempt, they will know that I am their God. How many of you know that our God is going to show up? That's why all this is happening. Because see, ISIS and all this stuff, and even government officials and presidents and prime ministers, they think, oh, I'm it. I'm my country's savior. No, I don't think so. You're not. God is. Everybody say amen. All right. Now, let's go to, just to cross-reference this, let's go to the Brit Hadashah in Acts chapter 10, the New Testament. Just to cross-reference this. Acts chapter 10. All right. You know the story. In Caesarea, they lived there. A Roman army officer named Cornelius, who was the captain of the Italian regiment. And he was a devout, God-fearing man. Even though he was Italian, he was God-fearing. Isn't that something? Amen? How many of you know there's a lot of Jews in Italy? Believe me, I think this guy was a Jew in the Roman Empire. At least he was a God-fearing man. He understood who Yeshua was. He gave generously to the poor and prayed regularly to God one afternoon. Now watch now. When he says he prayed regularly to God, remember, what is the time we pray? 9, 12, and 3, the Amidah, right? That's God's courtroom. That's the time we pray. I mean, we could pray any time, but that's the time that God is in session. 9 o'clock, 12 o'clock, 3 o'clock. Now watch this. One afternoon, about 3 o'clock, I'm pretty sure he was praying. At 3 o'clock, he was doing the Amidah, right? And he had a vision, which he saw an angel of God coming towards him. And how many of you know that when you're in session with God, supernatural things will happen? Cornelius, the angel said. Cornelius stared at him. So in other words, did he see things with his own eyes?
No.
He saw it with the eyes of God. Why? Because he was in the presence of God during 3 o'clock in the afternoon. All right? So Cornelius stared at him in terror. What is it, sir? He asked the angel. And the angel replied, your prayers and gifts to the poor have been received by God as an offering. Now send some men to Joppa and summon a man named Simon Peter. He is staying with Simeon, a tanner who, you know what a tanner is, a person that makes tents, who lives near the seashore. As soon as the angel was gone, Cornelius called two of his household servants and a devout soldier, one of his personal attendants, and he told them what had happened. And he sent them to. In other words, he saw things in God's eyes, right? And you know the story. The next day, Cornelius, the messenger, and all that, and I mean, things started happening. I don't have time to read the whole thing because I see the clock is kind of ticking kind of quickly, and we got to move on. But I want to give you some more points about this Torah portion, okay? All right, I want you to write down signs and wonders. Signs and wonders. Now, I want everybody to repeat after me. Say Torah, Israel, and Messiah. Okay, so I want you to see this in the spiritual, with the spiritual eyes. Now, what we will see tonight is that Moses is also a forerunner. We talked about this last week. It's the forerunner of Yeshua, right? Right? Because if you look at John chapter 5, verse 45, when Jesus was talking, Yeshua was talking, he was saying, it's not I who's going to accuse you. It's going to be Moses. Why? Because Moses wrote about me. If you would have believed what Moses had written, then you would have believed what I have said. Because they were questioning who he was. Right? Right? So what's going to accuse us at the end? The Torah. The word Torah, or God says you're going to show it. In other words, how much are we into the Hebrew roots? Because God's going to judge us by what we know in his word. Everybody say amen. That's why it's important to know the word of God. Right? So everybody say Yeshua, Moses. Right? Moses, Yeshua. Right? All right? So the Messiah Yeshua was in the very beginning, because how many of you know he was the beginning? And John 1 says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God. So that means that the Torah was in the beginning. Right? So we will see that the Torah will demonstrate and show the Messiah in different ways. Now, please know that there is no dispensation theology. Everybody say dispensation theology. What is dispensation? How many of you here do not know what dispensation theology is? Raise your hand. That's okay. Dispensation theology is what is called a replacement theology. It's a theology that we have heard the church say Israel had their opportunity. The Jews had the opportunity, so guess what? God kicked them out and shucked them away, and we're, the church, is going to be the one to usher in the Messiah. With Christmas trees and Easter bunnies and Sunday worship. I don't think so. I don't think so. How many of you know that? Because that's not who God is. God is about Passover, not Easter Bunny. God is about, you know, we observe his birthship. We understand that he was born, but how many of you know we do that during the Feast of Tabernacles? Right? So in other words, what I'm trying to say is that we cannot see things in our eyes or man's eyes. All right? We got to see things in God's eyes. And we have to have discernment to make sure we see it in God's eye. So understand that we don't believe in dispensation theology, that the church has replaced Israel, because we are Israel. And I was given a CD the other day. Is my sister here? I was given a CD the other day, and I heard the CD. And this is from a Messianic congregation here in Tampa. And the congregation, the person there is supposed to be, he's a rabbi, isn't he? And talking about how much he enjoys Christmas. And then he got into Christmas and all that stuff and the trees and everything else, how much he enjoys that, that he had his whole family involved in that. And I go, wow, that's kind of strange. I never heard a rabbi ever talk about that before. Kind of strange rabbi. So then he came into the two-house belief system that, well, you know, I have to go against the two-house belief system because they're saying that, you know, we are all rooted in Israel, and we are Israel. But he was trying to say is, if you're not a born Jew, and your name is not Berkowitz, then you're still a Jew, and everybody else is a Gentile. And he even said, I consider myself a Gentile. And I go, wait a minute. Because what does the word Gentile, now if you see it in God's eyes, in man's eyes, Gentile, in man's eyes, Gentile means non-Jew. In God's eyes, and the original meaning of Gentile, write this down, means confused, one that worships pagan idolatry. And if he's practicing Christmas, then I'm pretty sure that, I guess he's a Gentile. and one without God. In other words, one without God, what I mean, one without the God of the universe, the God who wrote this Bible. Because you got to be with the one that wrote this Bible. And you cannot go against what he said and what he wrote. But when you go against what he writes, how many of you know that's division? That's rebellion. All right? Okay? So again, we have to understand we cannot see things in our eyes. We have to see things in God's eyes. Now, you must understand that after Solomon reigned, you know how many of you know that the northern kingdom, he tried to explain all of that. And, you know, and to me, I try to read into his heart because I know he's confused, but he meant well because he wants unity. And at the end, he said, all I want is unity in the body of Messiah. And I want it too, but you can't keep on teaching two different theologies that there is two house systems, I mean, a one house system. Because what I mean by a one house system, okay, let me explain this a little bit so you understand why this is even how this came about. Back in the early 70s and 80s, how many of you ever heard of Jesus Christ Superstar? You know, the Jews were getting saved in colleges. You know, there was a big movement, a Jesus movement. And they were getting saved in droves. So what happened was now these Jews are coming into the churches. And they're seeing that the churches and the Jews are smart. How many of you know that smart? And so they went back into the Word, and they studied the Torah, because they're Jewish, and they look at the Messiah as Messiah, and say, wait a minute, he is the Torah, the walking Torah, but I'm in church, and they're practicing things. First of all, I'm here on the wrong day, because my Bible says Sabbath, and Sabbath is not Sunday, it's Friday to Saturday. So I'm here on a Sunday, so that's kind of out of kilter. Now I'm here with Easter bunnies and Christmas trees. That's out of kilter. So they decided to get out and start what is called the Messianic Movement. The first Messianic Alliance became the MJA, the Messianic Jewish Alliance. But they made a stupid rule that if you're not a Jew, because the reason for that is because they wanted to have their own entity. They wanted to have a Messianic congregation, do it on the Sabbath, do everything that again, Messiah taught to do. But at the same time, did not want to have all the influences of the regular church. So they made this rule that if you're not a Jew, you can't belong. Because what was happening, once they started their congregations, a lot of the people from the churches that were not Jewish joined them. And they wanted to be part of them. But they said, okay, but how are we going to, you know, make differentiate us from everybody else? So they made this rule, if you can't prove that you have Jewish blood, then you're a Gentile. You could be part of our Messianic congregation, but you're a Gentile. You could pay your tithes and you could help, but you're still a Gentile. And you don't call me a Gentile. All right? If I know who I am. All right? So that's how that got started. And that's been, and most of the congregation in America became part of the MJA, and it became a one-house system. But in Ezekiel 37, and he even mentioned the scripture, and he took it, and I said, wait a minute, no. He says it plainly. Ezekiel 37, take the house, he told Ezekiel, take one stick, that's Judah. Take the other stick, come on, that's Ephraim. Put the sticks together, they become one. And he even said that they become one, but he still says, I'm still a Gentile. It was very confusing. This man confused me. How many of you know that you got to be careful when you listen to people, all right? Because it has to line up with the Word. In other words, it has to line up with the eyes of God, not with the eyes of man, all right? So you know how that came about. But now to go back, let's go to Ezekiel. I want to go back to Ezekiel. I got about 5 minutes now. I'm running out of time. Ezekiel 9. Ezekiel 9. Unbelievable. So much confusion. Ezekiel 9, verse 4. I'm going to read this. Now watch this. This is seeing things with the eyes of God. We read this before. He said to him, we mean him. All right. Let's go to verse 3 so you see that. The glory of God of Israel rose up from between the cherubim where it had rested and moved to the entrance of the temple. And the Lord called the man dressed in linen who was carrying the writer's case. In other words, how many of you know he was walking with the Torah? He said to him, walk through the streets of Jerusalem and put a mark on the foreheads of all who weep and sigh because of the detestable sins being committed in their city. Everybody say a mark. Okay? Then I heard the Lord say to the other man, follow him to the city and kill everyone whose forehead is not marked. Show no mercy, have no pity. Kill them all. Old and young, girls and women and little children. And he said, wait a minute, man, this is weird. God is telling people to get killed? Wait a minute. But do not touch anyone with the mark. Begin right here. Watch this now. Everybody say, begin right here. And he says, where? At the temple. In other words, it begins in the house of God. It begins in the temple. The Mount of Olives. The Temple Mount. It began there. So they began to kill the 70 leaders, again, representing the 70 nations. Very prophetic. Now, what is he saying about the mark? In other words, there was a mark that was put on the people of God. What do you think that mark is? Well, we all know that, you know, the mark of God, because in the 144,000 that are going to be marked in the end of days, they're going to have the mark of God. Now, how many of you know they're not going to have a sign? They're not going to have a tattoo. They're not going to have a big emblem saying, I am God. I am from God. They're going to have a mark. In other words, a mark of protection. I believe the name of Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh is going to be there. But what is the mark? The mark, believe it or not, for all of us, is the Sabbath. In other words, if you read, we're going to get into, we're doing on Shabbat the second part of what? What did we taught last Shabbat? About the 10 directives, commandments, habits, right? Through the Hebrew eyes. We're going to break every commandment down. You're going to look at the Sabbath. If you read the Sabbath according to the Torah, it says, I what? Keep the Sabbath holy. For I am God and I am, in other words, keep the Sabbath holy for people to know that I am your God. And people will know that I, in other words, you are mine, right? So in other words, what is going to be the mark of the people of God in the last days? How are we going to know who is God's people and who are not? The Sabbath. Right? So again, he said that in his word. So people will know that I am your God and that you are my people. Right? Everybody say amen? So say the Sabbath is the mark that marks me from everybody else. All right? So God would know who you really are. All right? Now, the mark, of course, is his name. To stand for what? His name is Yahweh, Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, which means that he is the Lord of the Sabbath. Right? And that's his kingdom. That mark. Now, the name or mark would be also, write this down, a rod. We talk about that, the rod. Or a staff, the tree. That's why there's always a tree in the Torah. First of all, you have two trees. That's why there's two sticks inside the Torah scroll. One representing Judah, one representing Ephraim. One represented the house of Israel, one represented the house of Judah. You see? So, again, and the Bible says, and the two shall be one. When there is two or three or more in my name, then, come on, there's a witness in that. Right? There's a witness in two or three. If you're the only one, let me tell you this. I talk about this with people that are about to get married. If you're the only one, or you have someone that you're in, oh, I'm in love, and I'm the only one that I'm in love. In other words, you're in love, and you like this person, but you're the only one, and your father tells you no, and your mother tells you no, and your family tells you no, your pastor tells you no, your friends say, no, that's not the right. But you're the only one. How many of you know that's not God? Right? Because how many of you have even felt that it was God telling you to do something, you went upon and did it, and you look back later, and you know it wasn't God? How many? Raise your hand. Come on. Why? Because you didn't have a witness. You don't have a witness of two or three. All right? In the Bible says, in the multitude of godly counsel, there's safety, right? Okay? Now, so basically, to go back, we remember last week we talked about Moses when he threw the rod down. Remember the rod also, remember in those days, they used to mark the rod. The rod also had a genealogy of who they were. They marked. So when he threw the rod down, it became a what? A serpent, which was a representation of what could bite you, right? Of your past, right? Because even though he had the generation written on that staff, but God says, don't follow your past. Follow your future with me. When Moses was on the mountain, remember when he was on there? And God said, you cannot look at my face. You can only look at the back of me. Right? Why? Because he says, because if you, we cannot see God face to face. We'll all die. We can only see him when we, in the end of days, when we see him face to face. When we're in the spirit realm. But we cannot see him in the physical. Because again, God was telling Moses, I want you to see, I can't show you my face. I'm going to show you my back because I want you to see where you're going, not where you came from. Because once you see God face to face, he's going to show you where you came from. And you're not going to like it because the Bible says that it's like a big screen coming up. You're going to see your whole path. So God says, I want you to see where you're going, not where you're coming from. So always God is about future. Everybody say amen? All right. So everybody say, cast it down. We're going to close it to say, cast it down. Says, I'm going to cast down. Say, I'm going to cast down my future. I mean, my past, I should say. Not my future. Rebuke that in a heartbeat. Say, I'm going to cast down my past. My negative past. I surrender my life to God's future. Amen. Everybody say amen? All right? Because again, you can never go forward if you keep on living in the past. Amen? All right? So I wish I had more time to do this Torah study. I got 20 pages and I'm in page 2. So maybe we'll do part of this next week, I guess. All right? It's a lot to cover in an hour's time. Okay? And so we want to give time to Pastor Roman to do another song and close us out in an Aaronic prayer. But I want to also, if we could, I want to take up an offering for Pastor Bobby Roman. We're going to take an offering for the church. We're going to take an offering for him. Amen. I believe in giving the man of God what he, you know, what they deserve. Amen. And to me, the word of God says you give unto a prophet the prophet's reward, and you get a reward as you're giving to a man of God, right? So we're going to give.
say,
how God is greater, how God is stronger. God, you are higher than anything. God, you are higher than any other. God is healer, awesome in power. Oh God, oh God. And if our God, then who could ever stop? And if our God is with us, then what could stand again? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand again? Then what could stand again? Our God is great. Come on, I'm saying, our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. God is giver, awesome in power. Our God, oh, our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. God is healer, awesome power, our God. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then what could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? Stand again. Oh, how God is greater, how God is strong. God, higher than any other. God, awesome in power.
Come on, somebody.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, brother.
I want you to do the honors and do the Aaronic prayer tonight. Brother, brother. Amen. Yeah, we got to tape that. We got to tape this. Any way to tape this? Are you still taping? Oh, good, good. Tape it.
There you go. Piabare beja donai vish bereja. Isa donai pana beleja bihuneja. Isa donai pana beleja. Biasem leja. Shalom. The Lord will bless you and keep you.
Yes.
The Lord will cause his face to shine upon you.
Yes.
The Lord will be gracious to you.
Yes.
The Lord will give you his perfect.
Yes.
Shalom. Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, brother. God bless